Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. Special welcome to any guests we have and visitors who are here with us. We're glad you could be with us on this day that God has made. Please see your splash pad announcements. We say good morning to those watching online, if it's working right now this morning. And also, take a moment to send the water source books down each row and see what's going on, and greet those next who are seated next to you. We thank Team B this morning. We've got Janet, of course, at the keys, and Aaron Sifka and Jen Keywell, Kristen Johnson. We thank Team B for leading us in song. All right. We've got VBS coming up. There's five reasons you can see to sign up for Vacation Bible School, start the party, celebrate the good news. Number one, it's free. Two, we have treats and confetti. Number three, there will be surprise gifts. Four, we're going to a farm. And five, we'll celebrate Jesus and his love. So mark those dates. If you know some kids that'd like to come, we've got some youth volunteering as well as lots of other adult volunteers getting all set for the big week. That's going to be great. And that's the 28th of July through the 31st. We also have some Connect cards available out at the table. You can just take some and hand to kids. Any kids from the community are welcome to come. All right. So at the end of the service today, we have a send-off prayer for the group headed for the New Orleans National ELCA Youth Gathering. So we're looking forward to that. Josh and Colin Rock, a part of our group, are in transit right now with the vehicle that was rented down in the cities, and they'll be with us via the online link and so on too. But Jen's going to have a word of send-off for us as blessing at the end of the service. Mary's Mermaids are going to be selling bratwurst at Coburn's and Sauk Rapids coming up on the 27th, and we could use some more folks that would help with that. I believe there's a sign-up somewhere around here for that. If not, just call the church office. And then finally, you might have noticed when you came in, there's this interesting construction thing over that's taking place. It's a new, what would you call it, addition to the campus of Living Waters Lutheran Church. It's a gaga ball pit. So there was a team that went gaga building that yesterday, and it's looking really great. So thanks to all those who worked so hard this week to get that thing built. And we're going to look forward to kind of a kickoff gaga ball event with the H2O youth soon. All right. Any other announcements this morning? If not, then let's stand and sing our opening song, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Of mercy. Sisters and brothers in Christ, beloved children of God, grace, mercy, and peace be with you all.
And also with you.
We will now sing the Kyrie. You may be seated. Let us seek the face of God, the creator of wind and rain, field and ocean, the bread of life coming down from above, the power at work within us and this world. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. God of overflowing grace, we come to you with repentant hearts. Forgive us for shallow thankfulness. Forgive us for passing by the ones in need. Forgive us for setting our hopes on fleeting treasures. Forgive us our neglect and thoughtlessness. Bring us home from the wilderness of sin and strengthen us to serve you in all that we do and say through Jesus Christ, who is our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please take a moment for silent meditation. There is joy in heaven for every sinner who repents. By the grace of God in Christ, who gave himself up for us all, your sins are forgiven and you are made free. Rejoice with one another. We are home in God's mercy now and forever. Amen. Remembering that in baptism we are made children of God, marked with the cross of Christ forever, please make a sign of the cross on your forehead. We'll now sing the song of praise.
The reading today is from Psalm 85, 8 through 13. I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for you speak peace to your faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to you. Truly, your salvation is very near to those who fear you, that your glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness have met each other. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Faithfulness shall spring up from the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. The Lord indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness shall go before the Lord, and shall prepare for God a pathway.
This time I invite any kids over here. Come up for children's time. Any kids out there? I know there's one over there. Come on over. Brought the candy. What did I do? Anybody else? Kids 1 through 92. Hi. Good morning. You get shy when you're up here all by yourself with all these people? Not too bad. Yeah, well, today we are going to hear the words, for I'm listening to the Lord. I will listen to what the Lord God is saying. That's in the first reading that Terry just read. Hold on a second. Oh, hi, God. Hello. Hello. Thanks for calling. What would you like this morning for me to say? Oh, okay. Just talk about how, well, listen. We're going to be, we have another kid up here, God, with us this morning. Yes, there's a lot going on here at church. It's really great to see all these people here this morning. Yes, and we're listening to what you have to say to us. All right. Thank you. All right. Bye now. Bye. That was God. Right. I'm kidding. It wasn't really God, right? You know that. But you know, the point is with this text or this Bible passage, we hear how we can listen for God. How do you listen for God? Does God call us like that on the phone? Not really. But it says right here, I'll listen to what the Lord is saying. You speak peace to your faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to you. So when we turn our hearts to God, we believe the Bible says that we'll be able to hear God speaking. How do we hear God speak? How do we hear God? You think you can hear God in beautiful music? Think we can hear God in beautiful music? Do we hear God when Terry and other people read the Bible? Yes. Yep. Maybe when someone's talking here. Can we hear God in the sound of like a baby crying? It's a beautiful sound too. Yeah. That's the way we can hear God in different ways. So when God speaks, we can listen. It's pretty great as we learn what that means. All right. Well, let's pray. Dear God, thank you that you speak to us and that we can listen. Help us to listen for you. Amen. All right. And here's the candy. Take one for yourself and one to give away. There you go. Thanks for coming up.
Thank you.
Gospel according to Mark, the 6th chapter, beginning with verse 14. King Herod heard of the disciples' preaching, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason, these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As Minnesotans do in the summertime, Stephanie and the kids and I went up north one year camping. We went on a camping trip. And while a few miles beyond Ely, I engaged in the drama of resisting our campfire being extinguished. For a man, one's ability to successfully start a fire marks him apart as an accomplished outdoorsman, a capable caveman, upon whom the whole clan could count on to survive. There are hands and feet to be warmed, and things to be placed on sticks and roasted over the fire. Otherwise, it's just not a full camping experience. Without that, it's just not the same. So I had a lot riding on this as spouse and youngsters looked on in epic anticipation. But this time it was different. No matter what I tried, something kept that fire from taking off. Even the little fire starter things weren't working. And then finally, the blaze started out as this small glimmer of hope. And then it grew with breath directed at precise locations at the base of the glow. It was growing. It was finally taking off. I could feel the exhilaration. And then it started to rain. extinguished once again, and I'd have to wait for another day. It seemed that no matter what progress was made, something or someone was intent on keeping it from taking off. Throughout the Bible, there is this effort on part of the powers that be to silence the words of hope. There's a deliberate effort to extinguish God's plan for the world. When Jesus is born, Herod, it says, tried to have him killed by slaughtering all the male babies in the city, but he was unsuccessful. When John the Baptist comes crying, "In the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord," he's arrested and beheaded, as we read today. But the kingdom of God still comes. They can't stop it. Jesus himself is crucified by Pilate and the other authorities, and yet he rose again. When the apostles and the early Christians went out proclaiming the gospel and healing the sick, they were imprisoned. They were stoned to death, you name it. Many were killed. But still, that word of the gospel started people's hearts to burn with zeal and with love, to grow and grow. And before long, this little band of followers of Jesus Christ became thousands. Eventually, in the year 312 AD, the Emperor Constantine declared the entire Roman Empire to be Christian, virtually. Just like that. It can't extinguish the gospel. Herod tried. King Herod Agrippa, who had the John the Baptist beheaded, was one of Herod the Great's sons. And even though he built a beautiful temple, this guy's father would have made it into the tabloids at the supermarket. The Herods are kind of vassal kings of the Romans. They were Jewish of background, but they were placed in power kind of to help try and control those in Israel. Even though he built this beautiful temple, this guy's father would have made it into tabloids. Herod the Great had one of his 10 wives executed along with his mother-in-law. Oh, and I remember seeing the site where traditionally he kept her body in a coffin full of honey because he did love her. He made Dr. Evil and Scott and Mini-Me seem like healthy, well-adjusted individuals. For those not familiar with the culture reference, I apologize. No kidding, though. When we hear about how this Herod married his brother's wife and saved face before his friends after promising Herodias his daughter whatever she wished after a steamy dance, and consequently had John the Baptist's head brought to his birthday party, read it, that's what he did. We are struck with the scandal of it all. No matter how the powers that be may try to snuff out God and preserve the tabloid headlines for themselves, God's love is what changes lives and survives all the shrinking and the swelling of history. In communist Russia, when asked once what his ultimate goal was, Vladimir Lenin, leader, said, "To dethrone God." Some of the churches where people had worshiped were turned into swimming pools or war museums. But grandmothers had hidden Bibles and passed on the faith to their grandchildren under threat of consequences and death. With changes in East Bloc countries, we've witnessed in our lifetime how the world has been amazed at how, with religious freedom, now the churches survive all along under such oppression. same as in communist China after. It's just amazing. One of the miracles of the last century, the growth of the church there in the midst of all that oppression. You can't extinguish the gospel. It might look like it sometimes on the surface, but it can't be extinguished. Consider how the proclaimers of the gospel live on in our country. Our group is planning on stopping at the National Rights Museum in Memphis, Tennessee, on the way to the ELCA National Youth Gathering this week. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. was martyred there. And the words from his famous speech, "I have a dream," will echo throughout history. That one day this nation will rise up to live up to its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last. As the band U2 put in a song in the name of love, "Free at last, they took your life. They cannot take your pride." They can't extinguish the gospel. Some will try because the gospel strikes them as not making sense of the world the way that they might. Something about the whole world being saved because of some carpenter's son just doesn't go with the grain to the world at first. But God doesn't do things like we might do them. Jesus dying on a cross and rising again has appeared as a scandal to minds that cannot accept God carrying out the grand plan in this way. In fact, that's exactly how the gospel is described in the Bible, as a stumbling block. In the Greek, the word is scandalon, a scandal, something people get tripped up on. To Herod and company, the scandal that surrounded their own tabloid lives did not grab the headlines like this did. But maybe that's the point. Excuse me. God, by working in opposites sometimes, gets our attention and shapes in us an alternate vision of what life is about. Powers that be have tried, as a result of our fallen nature of humanity, to say even that God is dead. As I remember an old Randy Stonehill song, as he put it, "But it must sound odd to the ears of God, who's given us the tongues to speak." God is alive, Jesus said. And his church is his body, still living on in this world, healing as he healed, teaching as he taught, loving as he loved. I can still hear Dave's beautiful voice. He'd come into town to the cafe every day to have a cup with friends in a small town where I was pastor once, my first call. After a surgery to re-strengthen his knee, where his leg had been severed years ago as his pastor, I went out to his farm to see him. Dave was a big man, and he didn't often show emotion as a Norwegian male. That was part of it. But he'd get very emotional when he'd tell you only privately about the kind of angel he saw and heard the day that he fell into the farm machinery early in life, and it was tearing him apart. "David, you're going to be okay," he said, the voice, the person, the presence said to him. And he knew he'd be all right then, he said. Most of all, he felt the greater comfort in those words. "David, you're going to be okay." It was like God was assuring him of more than just his physical security, but also his spiritual. And he didn't fear God as an enemy, but he knew in his heart that God loved him and he was okay for the horizon of eternity. And he said he wouldn't wish a tragedy of losing a leg upon anyone. But he said he wouldn't have had this assurance that he had about the goodness of God if it hadn't happened. Even through tragedy, God can bring life and unextinguishable joy. So, when Dave sang for us one morning with all his heart in church, you couldn't believe this beautiful tenor voice that made you think, what's Pavarotti doing living on a farm? Those words really stuck with you when he was done, as he sang about Jesus saying, go ahead, drive the nails through my hands, and very soon you will see I will rise again. There ain't no power on earth can tie me down. I will rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. As time marches on, there will be rulers who try to snuff out the fire of God. Herod tried. Roman emperors tried. Ideologies and their spokesmen have tried. The devil himself tries, but it cannot be extinguished. But Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. To God be the glory, now and forever. Amen. We sing our song of the day, and at this time we receive this morning's offering. One in the communion of saints and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer. Lord, you gather your people into the body of Christ. Where your church is wounded, heal it. Where it is right, strengthen it. Where it is divided, reunite it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. From before the foundation of the world, you are God. Revive ecosystems destroyed by human greed. Curb our desire to put wealth ahead of the health of all who call this planet home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You establish equity and make justice with every nation, tribe, and land. Cause laws to be written and customs to be observed that protect the most vulnerable. Lord, in your mercy, your prayer. On the cross, your beloved Son endured pain and death. Bring healing to those in need, hope to any in despair, and comfort to the dying. We pray, Lord, for your hand of healing, Lord, this day upon Judy Steeney and Nathan Strenge, Kathy Rasmussen, Ben of Ankeny, Iowa. We pray for your healing on Bill Marfort, recovering from surgery. We pray for Dixon, Brenda Wright's niece's husband, for healing for him. We ask your healing upon Jen Kewell's uncles, Jim Dyrhaug, for Holly, friend of Brenda and Tim Wright, for Jesse Quimby, Kelly Peterson's friend Trish, for Candace, sister of Ted Helgerson, and those we name before you in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You send your Spirit into this community of faith. Empower our ministries that serve and build up local communities. Nurture our partnerships with other community organizations, such as the Place of Hope, the Dream Center, and Salvation Army. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, for peace in your world, peace in the wake of terrible violence, in the wake of the shootings, the rally in Pennsylvania. We pray, Lord, for healing for former President Trump and comfort for the families of those who were killed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for peace between Russia and Israel, or Russia and Ukraine, and Israel and the Gaza Strip and Palestinians. We pray for resolution to these terrible conflicts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As peoples praise you, O God, we give you thanks and praise for the lives of loved ones who now rest in you, especially those we now name before you in our hearts. In the fullness of time, gather us with all your saints in light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one who is the way and the truth and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share a sign of peace with those sitting around us. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God, Creator, Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Jesus, you are the bread of life, bread broken to mend all broken dreams, broken people, broken homes, and broken hearts. Break the good news lovingly to all struggling spirits that you are nourishment to anyone who hungers for life. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This time I invite those who are helping to serve communion to come forward. We welcome everyone to the Lord's table, knowing that with the bread and the wine, we receive the body and blood of Jesus for the strengthening of our faith and for the forgiveness of our sins. There's grape juice available for those requests, and also we have gluten-free, corn-free wafers for those requests. The table is ready. We come and eat.
The sin of the world.
Lord be with you. Generous God, send us your servants into all the land that we may act wisely, seek the good of our neighbor, and call others to come to the feast through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. At this time, I invite those who are getting ready to travel to New Orleans to come forward. We have a sending here. Jen Kewell is going to read the part of pastor, so we're just going to ordain Jen this morning. And she's going to do a sending prayer for us. Josh Rock and Cullen are currently in transit once again with the Suburban coming from St. Paul Airport. So they assure me they're watching online. So they also may have a prayer, a blessing. Pray for your prayers for us as we travel in this eventful week. It's going to be quite an experience, and going to serve in Jesus' name. All right.
You have the commission, service of commissioning in your bulletin if you would like to follow along. Claimed by God, crafted with your own authentic gifts, you are a brave community of disruptive disciples called to be participants in the 2024 ELCA Youth Gathering. In this, there will be times when you feel energized and times when you feel exhausted, times when you enjoy every activity planned and times you wish you were in charge, times when the Holy Spirit will show up in joy and times when the Holy Spirit will show up in challenge. And so I ask you, will you use your braveness for the sake of the gospel as you step into the journey ahead? If so, respond with, "We will," and we ask God to help and guide us.
We will.
Will you use your authenticity to enrich the gathering and the community of New Orleans?
We will.
Will you freely participate in the gathering and with the people of New Orleans with the love and compassion of Jesus? Will you seek to disrupt injustice, working together in solidarity for the sake of your neighbors?
We will.
Will you be respectful, curious, helpful, open, and kind?
We will.
And now I ask the congregation, will you, led by the Holy Spirit, pray for these youth gathering participants in your daily prayers, asking for God's guidance, love, safety, and blessing in their endeavors? And upon their return, will you receive them and their stories and experiences with love and openness?
We will.
Almighty God, guide, bless, and keep you in your travels and your safe return. Amen. Thanks be to God. We do have a tradition in at Living Waters to give out stones. So I do have stones for each of you.
So we'll be up bright and early. All right, let's stand and sing the sending song. Stay standing for a sending song, just a closer walk.
Just a closer walk with thee.
Go in peace, and serve the risen Lord.
Thanks be to God. Lord.